I actually really randomly went to see in the day whatever I could fit in. But I saw some other films which are much celebrated and which I hated, and I'm not going to tell you what they were.
I bet I can guess.
Yeah. Oh, really? It's a conversation later.
Yeah. Don't okay. feel obliged to wait for me to ask a question.
Great. Anyway, so as I was saying...
Yes.
I'm sure you guys are much more interesting together than I am. So.
Well, I think that's probably true.
No. Expect that.
I think we guys are much more interesting than she is. Yeah.
Yes, that is true.
Whatever tryout we can work out. But you were injured. What did happen to you?
I fell on my collarbone during a filming in Ireland, in Dublin. I got over enthusiastic and just threw myself through the air. It was a stunt fight comedy thing, and I was trying to be funny. And
yeah, she always takes the blame when other people were at fault, but mm-hmm. she's pretending now that she was responsible, and I know that's not true.
But
she's too nice for everybody.
Natural disposition. Well, is she happy-go-lucky? Is she as
a nightmare? I'm a nightmare, am I?
She look, you know, people. Somebody just now said, so Sally is Poppy. And of course, that is rubbish, and we would both be the first to tell you that. Mm-hmm. That's right, isn't it?
Yes.
Sally is, you see her in any number of movies, and she is extraordinarily versatile. She's done a complete spectrum of characters. She's a great character actress. And, but you know, you couldn't do Poppy, a character that we've collaborated, haven't we, to invent, because that's how I work. You couldn't do Poppy unless you had Poppy's, the energy and that. Mm-hmm. humour and the intelligence and the exuberance and the joie de vivre that Poppy has too. Sally has that, but she has other things too.
Yeah. No, that's sorry. Thank you. That's very nice.
Actors love talking about themselves, don't they?
I know. It's a grind to a halt.
Well, was this the full Mike Leigh process? I mean, last time we chatted, it was... was a much more serious movie.
I don't think it's true. I don't know what movie it was. What movie was it?
It was a Vera Drake.
No, I don't think Vera Drake is a much more serious movie. I think that the films are as serious as each other. And they both have warmth. I mean, you know, here's a description of Poppy. Mm-hmm. She's positive. She's generous. She's got a sense of humour. She's caring. She cares for other people. She looks out for other people. She's tender. That is a description of Vera Drake as well. There's a great... let nobody think... I mean, it is called Happy Go Lucky, and we are celebrating being optimistic and positive in this film. Mm-hmm. But there's a seriousness about this film, isn't there? We're quite serious
absolutely.
About life.
Yeah.
And as serious as I am with Vera Drake. Mm.
And there are elements... I mean, Vera Drake, there's... I love about Mike's work. I mean, and also because it's. I mean, life is. It's both simultaneously funny and tragic, and in Vera Drake there are some just incredibly funny moments as well.
And warm moments.
Yeah, and usually involving Eddie, of course.
Eddie Marsan, who plays Scott, the driving instructor.
But Mike always gets. Life out of everybody. I mean, that seems to be the end result of this process is to
get
reality, no matter what era or no matter what tone is being set.
Yes, yeah, and also, you're constantly, every moment is accounted. What I love about Mike's work is it's so incredibly rich that it's just every moment is packed with so many different things that it's... like the tiniest minutiae, it's you know, you kind of push so much into the, like a beat and a nanosecond, and that's what's so challenging and makes you incredibly, you have to be on your toes all the time and be using your brain and your creativity, and it's always sort of, oh, what's that?
Nuclear
somebody farted.
Yeah. Sorry. I don't even know I'm doing it.
But the thing is, it's about, you know, what this is all
about.
we're talking about putting characters on the screen like real people. And that's my kind of lifetime obsession, really. As a kid, I used to watch movies and think, you know, it'd be great if you could have a film where people were like real people really are. You know? And I love the movie. I'm a sucker for all kinds of movies, phony they are. But still, that's my thing. And what you're talking about is, you know, the fact that, you know, we're so conditioned to looking at acting in movies as this kind of generalized, you know, actors behaving like actors, not really doing characters as in real people, but just doing a kind of bland sort of selected form of behavior. And this is about really making every moment resonate with reality. And it therefore has got to be dense. And absolutely, every moment is specific, and the characters are unique and specific in the way that we are in life. You know, that's what it's all about. Yeah. And we have great fun when we're creating this character.
Yeah, it's definitely.
God, what was the nub you started with in this case?
Can't tell you that. It's a trade secret. But I mean, you know, we did spend it worked for all the characters in the film, but we particularly spent a huge amount of time, just the two of us.
Yeah,
we just sitting and talking into existence and talking about all kinds of different people and people
absolutely.
That Sally knows and, you know, just kind of...
Yes, totally. And it's, when people ask about the sort of rehearsal process and are quite surprised and think, well, what do you do? I mean, 6 months, that's ridiculous. And it's very important and it's a real luxury. And it's every... You know, think about it, every day, every moment, is packed with, you need it, and you need, because you're doing so much and you're creating this whole world. And you think about your own world and your own, and how complex you are as a person and how many references sort of affected you as a kid or as or music and art and everything and memories or just dreams, everything. It's infinite. 6 months actually isn't it? I mean, it could go on.
Yeah, it's true.
On and
thank goodness it doesn't. I mean, the thing is, what we do for that time is prepare. We prepare for on the first day. We get around together, and I always say, as I did on this film, you know, we're going to just bring in to existence this world in order that in 6 months' time we can go out and make up a film on location, and that's what we do. Really, what we did. So. There isn't ever really a script in any conventional sense, and certainly nothing on paper. But what is filmed is very precise.
But did you start with Poppy's energy? Did you say that's a character? Is that a direction I want to
go?
No,
I've already told you that
you
what
I
had is
know,
a but nice try.
Yes,
he's good.
Very good. You came on the other way.
Yes, you know what I do. Probably.
I mean, what I love is the idea that he thinks I'm that
come
stupid.
Yeah.
He thinks I'm that stupid. You know?
He'll catch you unawares. I'll distract him, and then you ask the question again.
Just wave up behind him.
Now you've rephrased the question, I'm happy to answer it.
I can tell you've done this before.
Yeah. Two times.
I actually had one interview. The one interview of my entire life that I thought I lost was I was doing an interview with Tommy Lee Jones in a movie that was truly horrible, and I was trying to get him to say it, admit it, essentially.
Right. Yeah.
And he finally said about 2 minutes into the interview, he goes, I'm not going to give you what you're trying to get from me. And that was it. It was all
right.
It was
well,
all.
I'm not trying to give you what you're trying to get from me.
So what was, I mean, is it different for you once you're on set? I mean, I mean, obviously the whole experience is unlike any other experience. There's no, I mean, I always think that every actor should go to the Mike Leigh School of Acting.
Yeah, so do I.
For a period to have
so
this experience. I think they all go to theater to do kind of what you do in some ways.
I don't think they will find it there.
Well, they're working with the rigidity of the script in theater.
It's not just about that. It's about, you know, as far as I'm concerned, it's about, it's about elevating actors to the status of artists in their own right, you know, creative, collaborative contributors in their own right. And that's what it's about, basically. Mm. And I think on the whole, I mean, there are contexts in which that happens, but not very many. Mm. But you were saying.
Well, when you're on the set, I mean, is it like when you're shooting, when you're actually shooting, is it like the experience of being on any other movie? Is it, do you go out of character and go?
What's lovely is the extraordinary discipline on set and focus. Though it's quite rare, unfortunately. But with Mike, I mean, when you go on to another sort of project, immediately realize that there's not quite so much sometimes.
You mean when you go into a project after having worked with
Mike? Yes, yeah, sorry. Thanks, translation.
No, it's just that you said with Mike. I don't want anyone thinking I come with, because I don't. I don't want to be there.
No, right, sure. but there's an extraordinary focus, and Mike will tell you to go to warm up before you start, the camera turns over. Mm-hmm. And so you're already focused, you're already in character, you already know what you're doing, and you're there, and you're in. And it's not until Mike's happy with, and he knows just by by watching you, strangely, whether you're in character or not, and whether you're right, and whether you're at the right moment and ready.
And then
really.
I'll start.
And sometimes you don't even hear, because you're in, you don't even hear action, because it's so smooth, it just flows.
I mean, there is a level on which, I mean, our producer, Simon Channing Williams, who I've worked with for many, many years, does always say that it's very much, in the end, at another level, it's very much like proper, like any film, because we work to the disciplines of filmmaking. I like to shoot classically. I mean, in other words, there are no tricks. We don't pretend the camera isn't there or hide the lighting or any of that. It's very, very, very. It's very much like making a movie, except, I mean, one of the things that always happens, and I think this relates to what you're reporting, is that about 2 weeks into the shoot, you will hear like an electrician who's never worked on one of my films before say, I don't get it. These actors, there's no script, they know the lines, they're throwing no wobblies, they're behaving themselves.
Wobblies.
They're harmonious, they're behaving well, and they, you know, and it's because the actors are really secure, and they've rooted in the foundations of the thing, and they know it word perfectly, and it's just, so therefore they can. So what you can do is take off, can't you, and really explore in the proper creative sense, you know.
Yes,
it's about the moment, about liberating the moment, you know.
Yeah, and you do feel incredibly supported and incredibly sort of held, you know, and there's an extraordinary amount of trust, and you know where you're supposed to be. I mean, of course, you have... You go home at night and you think about it, you worry about, but that's something else, you know. And
but you know, I think the thing is, what's important too is that, you know, here's Sally, who carries a lot of this, pretty much the whole film in the conventional sense. Mm-hmm. And you know, I've worked with Sally. We worked together for the first time in 2001 on All or Nothing, at which time you had some. A few years theatre experience and very little film experience.
I didn't have any film.
No, now by the time we get to Happy Go Lucky, and Sally, of course, also Vera Drake, but she's also done loads of other films. I mean, you know, all the stuff that we're talking about is specific to the creative thing here. But of course, the other massive bonus is that Sally is a very experienced film actor. In all kinds of films, and that is very important too, you know. I mean, although there are people in the film who are first timers, I make it work for first timers. You shouldn't underestimate the fact that I do. I mean, the great exception in this film, that there is a remarkable performance by an 8-year-old kid. Was he 8? And who is just fantastic. Never acted before at all.
Extraordinary.
Just a natural, you know.
That's
and not,
how you do it.
Not playing himself, you know, just doing a character that we talked in. But that's an exception, because I like to work with real professional actors who bring professionalism to it. Mm-hmm. And that's very important, because people very often confuse the whole improvising thing with the idea that it's kind of about people not acting, or people just being themselves, or people just off the street, and all that's nonsense. It's about acting.
Was the natural built-in ability, after you've done it for long enough, to know how to, for instance, deal with a camera and deal with images, or is it just how you behave on the set and the work ethic you bring to it when you say professionalism?
No, I mean the work ethic you bring to it, and how you, and also, no, and I'm dealing with a camera too, and but then what you would say is you don't, working with me, I suppose you don't think about the camera.
No, you don't, you're not aware at all, and it's not your responsibility to be
and where it is, or Mike watches the, you know, you have a rehearsal and you're on set and you're going where you would go in character and be, and then Mike will make it work around that, around the choreography that's natural and right. And
but I mean, you know, but on the other hand, because you're so solid in the character, I'm able to very much move it around and challenge it and change it and make it.
But it never feels artificial.
You don't, no,
and
exactly.
It never feels compromised.
No, and I think what you're actually talking about, which is interesting, is that, you know, Michael Caine's actually somewhere in this building.
Is he really?
I saw him last night. Julie Walters, when Julie Walters first, when Julie Walters did Educating Rita with him, she said to me, I said, how was it? She said, well, he's great to work with, but, you know, he kept saying, well, you know, because there was an eyeline problem, and he said, well, play it to my shoulder, you know, or pretend, look over there, and, you know, and so, and then there are all the stuff about actors, you know, worried about which side, and, you know, actors wanting to know which lens and where, how, and of course that, for my money, simply gets in the way of the acting.
Yeah.
And so my job, and I say our job behind the camera, is to create something which makes it possible to actually focus on what it matters, which is the character and what's going on. You know?
And if you're thinking about that, you're not in character.
It's impossible. Obviously,
you're thinking, you're third-eyeing yourself, and you're being self-conscious, and you're worrying about what lens it is.
But you've had those experiences in other films.
Yes, and people asking whether I want to see rushes and things, and I just, no, thank you.
I will not let actors see rushes, and on the whole, the kind of sensible actors I work with don't want to see the rushes.
No.
But it doesn't. When I was a young actor in one particular film in the 60s, in the early 60s, I every day at lunchtime we would all pile into this little theatre in the Shepperton Studios and watch the rushes, and I was doing tiny bits in it, but the main actors, I saw their performances disintegrate daily, because every day they tried to take on board what they thought they'd learnt from the rushes, and it's good. And there are people that, I mean, Gina Rowlands, who you can only respect, is absolutely the opposed view, and says that she has to see the rushes, and it's part of her process. Fair enough, but I don't see it.
Well, the word safety that you used earlier was, I think, what, you know, and these other pictures. I mean, Michael Caine is in enough movies with enough directors who really don't know what they're doing that I guess he has to direct it on some level.
Well, I think that's right.
Role as an actor.
I think you're right. I mean, it is about, I mean, and you've experienced this a lot, I know, that, I mean, you know, a lot of acting is about learning coping mechanisms to deal with the exigencies and the shortcomings of the conditions you work in.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. And that's just something that you don't have to think about, something working with Mike. You know, you're just so cushioned, and you think, oh, that's, it gives you that freedom to actually work. It can be so stressful if you're, because you there's no trust if you're worrying about what's going on sort of on that side, you know, and yeah, that's not your responsibility, really.
I mean, I people say to me, and they just have lately, say, well, you know, why don't you, you know, if you've got a really good script, you could really, you know, get a lot of
really
money.
Really do some good work.
Well, yeah. You can make a lot of money, actually, which doesn't happen to me. And, the point is, I mean, there's no question that I won't do that, but I couldn't, because in the context of what we're talking about, apart from the fact that I'm only interested in my own work and et cetera, et cetera, it's only because, I mean, directing films is terrifying. I'm as terrified as anybody else. You know, I work with the great cinematographer Dick Pope, and we work together. We've got complete harmony in the way we work. But in fact, it's tough. You know, finally working out how to do these things is tough. So, and then working with actors is, I mean, to have to do all that without that half a year preparing for it and really laying the foundations, I don't think I could do it, basically. I don't think I could just come in and, I don't know how, I don't know, I wouldn't, and so it's the foundations that make it possible for us to really have a, a rapport on the go, which that means it can then deal with all these exigent problems which are still there, you know. I mean, you know, those car scenes, you know, I mean, they were...
Terrifying.
I mean, you know, the actors, Sally and Eddie are really driving. I insisted they had to be driving, for real, because it's not the kind of stuff you can do on a low loader where you're having a conversation about something else and, you know, doing occasionally remember to look at the road. Right. They had to react to the world.
Yeah.
And so the car was rigged with, you know, these tiny high-definition lipstick cameras and combined with a 35mm camera and light rig. And it was a brilliant piece of thing. We had three versions of the car, you know, what.
Yeah.
And all that was a massive headache and a massive... But actually, in the end, it was what a great thing to do, wasn't it?
It was.
You know.
It was extraordinary, and that, like you say, you know, you there was no, you didn't have a, you know, a camera there or a camera, and you're on the blue screen, and it's just you're there in the world, and you.
Eddie's shouting lines from another room.
You were in a
I was unusually
somewhere.
Normally I'm there, but I was in the truck behind you.
Over a monitor, or just hearing it,
just hearing it. But that's a technicality. But the point is that it's you know, if we didn't. Well, I suppose what I'm saying is if we hadn't got the groundwork in it, we also spent lots of days, non-shooting days, rehearsing and rehearsing those scenes, sometimes just sitting in a room on two chairs. You know, we had to get it right, you know, just to get the dialogue right and to get it, because it's so precise, you know.
So could that relationship have gone somewhere else completely in the rehearsal process and become the movie?
Well, that, you know, you could ask the same question about any art, or any movie, because it doesn't matter what you're watching, whether you're looking at a painting or a novel that somebody's written or another movie that's been scripted, somebody's improvised and then put order on it and created something. So everything's got options. What, as far as I'm concerned, I think you would, I suppose, feel the same in it from the point of view of doing Poppy, that, you know, we built it. We had all kinds of choices when we explored that relationship, particularly the climax. It went in all kinds of directions within the overall thing, and we, you know, distilled from them. And you get it, what feels like right.
So
the answer is no more than in anything else. There's always, something else that could have happened, but it seemed to me that this is what it's about. I mean, certainly the idea that anything other than what happens between Poppy and Scott at the end would be meaningless. It has to be the way it is.
Yes, and that's quite interesting. When we were at that point, at quite the sort of crux, well, or one
climax,
of them. There were several options that we did investigate, but actually when we would sort of dissect it at the other end or talk about it, there was something that you weren't quite happy with or didn't feel quite right and wasn't...
It's dramatic choices.
Yeah, but so it was the one that... was right.
Yeah, you arrive at what you arrive at. What has been, and actually, when you think about what the film is about, and the way, you know, it can only be what it is. Really, I mean, it's not.
Yeah.
It's about her knowing how to deal with things, knowing how to cope, knowing how to still caring, but knowing, you know, that she has to walk away, and seeing what's happened to him, and seeing, you know, all of those things.
Yeah.
And it's about his complete disintegration, and all those things are, you know, and of course. Ultimately, in the next and final scene, you know, it's about, I don't want to talk about it, anyway,
right.
People are going to see it, you know, but it's, finally, she's in the right place, you know, and all the right things.
Yeah,
it's amazing. It's a hard line for Eddie to walk, I think, as much, I mean, your character is kind of driven forward, whereas he's on such a tightrope in this story, because he's such a possibly unlikable character, so, you know, dangerously close. And you see him in other pictures coming off of the work with you, you know, getting hired in America for, you know, the Will Smith movie or whatever, where he's just a rage maniac, and, you know.
But don't forget, in Vera Drake, he played a really nice guy, you know.
Well, that's, we see him, in your films, we actually see him being able to act.
Well, I hope that's true of everybody you see in my films. That's what it's about.
I think the genius of Eddie, he's extraordinary. Ability, because you like you say, he has this character is, I mean, he's horrific, and he's got that's such a huge generalisation. He's actually not, because that's a gift of his gift. That he, you actually by the end, you really feel for that character and see, you see the crack and you see
the vulnerability.
Yeah, and there's the child and the human and something that's gone wrong, and that's really sad, because you obviously there's something lost there. And
but also I think it's important. When you ask me this question, you ask this question, but my answer to the question specifically about could it have gone some other way, you know, that's talking about this relationship as though it was the only thing in the film. But of course, you know, you have to see it in terms of what Poppy's about, and that you have to see Scott in relation to the kid who teaches, who's got a problem. She teaches who's got a problem, and the old guy she meets in the night. And you have to, you know. So in a way, there's a theme. There are underlying, from my point of view, of course, there are underlying themes and objectives in the film, which aren't just a matter of what could have happened in the improvisations. The film has a dramatic and thematic agenda of some kind in some implicit way.
Well, it's remarkable how in all these processes you get these performances, or the performances come, and, you know, in some ways movie stardom is with Michael Caine and others about, you know, that creating that, the Michael Caine of it all.
Yeah.
You know, you go to see a movie, you see Michael Caine, you go to see Michael Caine as something,
right,
as opposed to Michael Caine falling into something as a role. But yet, in the process of doing this in such an intimate way, you seem to get the inherent character of the actor to come through in a way that becomes defining for a career, becomes the thing that people remember about them. It's quite remarkable.
Yeah, well, it's not about, it's not, I don't like it to watch a film and actually see the actor, like that jars you out.
You want to see the character.
Yeah, it's
me too.
It's not really about me or them. It's not, that's not really interesting. It's
no, but what you're saying, however, I think that's right. But what you're saying is that nonetheless, somehow something of the actor is there, and that's of course right. I mean, you know, in the end, I mean, the truth of the matter is that this funny convention of this medium that was invented 12 years ago, you know, in the end, it is about this little machine that records a reality, which is Sally Hawkins in front of the camera. That is what it is, actually. And so everything we do is a massive, sophisticated con. So that you can then be absolutely natural as yourself, but actually because of the illusion of both for us and for you of being somebody else.
Yes.
You know?
But
in the end, you know, there's always a certain imprimatur of a particular actor on the character. I mean, I've worked with lots of people, not least Sally, many times. We've had to work together three times, totally different characters. I mean, really, really different. And they couldn't be more different. I mean, the difference between Susan, the posh girl who has an abortion, which she pays for and goes to a psychiatrist in Vera Drake, and Poppy is huge. But it would be disingenuous to say that when you look at those two characterizations, you don't see Sally Hawkins in there too, because of course you do.
Yeah.
But you know, if I just said to Sally, okay, well, I know, just be yourself, and this woman is 1950 and she's posh and she's having an abortion, or be yourself, and she's
said,
you know, we'd have done it in a day. That would have saved 6 months. You could have done something, you could have done another two movies.
Yeah.
But you know, it wouldn't have, you know,
yeah.
So there's all that too. But in the end, we're not concerned with that, are we? We're concerned with telling stories about people out there in the street.
Yeah, and I suppose there is a place for, you know, going to see, you know, that sort of a star, you know, and seeing them, and you're interested in that.
Yeah.
And there is, I suppose, there's a fashion for that, or that's a place.
Well, it's always been there. But then again, you're only looking at people playing the role of being themselves on the screen.
Yeah.
Well, there's so many Imeldas, for instance, going back to Vera Drake, that's, you know, we've seen her, we were actually familiar with her for a long time before that movie, and then that was another piece of it, and then she goes back and does other things, and you take her with you. And for Sally, you know, this is the most time most of us, certainly in the U.S., have spent with you.
Yeah, sorry about that.
No, it's, well, we are too, and we're feeling we're going to see more of you.
Oh.
So it's a great thing. Yeah. See, is that part difficult? Is the, I mean, you're, all this attention has come now.
Oh, it's, I mean, it's lovely, really. I mean, what a beautiful film to be, to be here with, you know? And to think back, I was just saying to half an hour ago that when we were creating, like day one, you think we had no idea where we'd be or what film it was or what character it would be. And then to think that we're here now in Toronto at Film Festival, I mean, it's extraordinary.
But you wait till I'm long dead and you're old and you go
Stop
to a,
it.
And you go to a, oh, listen,
What's
listen,
like?
Let me finish this.
I don't want to hear this.
And you go to a, and the Film Festival shows a film that was made 50 years ago and you go, very old lady, and you, and
as an old lady,
yeah, and you, and they say, what was it like working with, what's
okay.
it,
what,
What was that working with Mike Leigh? No, Mike Leigh, sorry.
Yes, what was his
no,
name?
No, so what I'm saying is, what I'm actually saying is that you're talking about the extraordinary thing in the way, but in fact it will go on and on being.
I went
to the Locarno Film Festival and they showed my first film, Bleak Moment, which won the prize there in 1973. And I went to the screening there, you know, I mean, it's
that's
really
amazing.
That's weird, you know. I mean, it's
but that's
of,
lovely.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
Well, it'll be, and you'll enjoy it when I'm dead, and you.
Stop it! No.
And you'll be old.
And you'll be old.
And with your arm
and
in
you're
a,
hated.
With your arm in a sling.
Different sling. But I mean, there is some benefit to getting old, no?
Pardon?
There's some benefit to getting old.
Yep. We're not gonna have to put up with it for so long. No.
It changes a lot, doesn't it? I mean, what was the moment where you knew that this form was what you kind of had to do? Was there a
form? You mean this way of making movies?
This way of making movies.
Oh, when I was 21.
And there was really no ever question about it since then?
No. It takes a lifetime to work a thing out, you know?
Mm. Absolutely. Well, that's the thing. You actually have a lifetime. I mean, it's hard to imagine. I mean, this performance is so kind of mesmerizing, and obviously people in different countries and people all over the place are embracing it, but it's, you know, you'll grow as an actor, I imagine, or as a human being. And
yes, you hope so. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I have to say, you know, just for the record, that, I mean, I've made 18 full-length film with a lot of actors, and you will hate me for saying this, but I have to say that working with Sally is very special indeed. It takes you to another place. Aww. It's really remarkable.
Thank you. You make me cry.
Because she's
well,
her work, or because she's
well,
the energy
she has?
Well,
you say the same thing about Mike.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, you never learn as much as you do when you're working on Mike Leigh film. But that's very nice.
It's just something kind of. She just brings an openness and an energy and a warmth and a humour and a love to everybody, you know. Mm. Everybody, you know, there's a thing that spreads from Sally. And that's there in the film. You can see it in the movie, you know.
Well, it seems like the perfect match in that way, because you create the opportunity for that to spread. You know, it's not a narrow box where she has to work it out and then show up.
No,
exactly.
I think that's right. That's it.
Yes, too. I mean, you know, it's...
And we have a laugh, don't we?
No, it's the best working experience. If I can work with Mike the rest of my life,
We'll see what we can arrange.
Okay. Right.
I was thinking earlier about the bicycle scene at the very beginning when you find the bicycle's not there.
Yes.
And I thought in so many movies that would be, you know, you would work that out 3 months ahead of time. And,
sure.
You know, it would be just whatever the gimmick was of the physicality of it and so forth.
Yeah.
And it just seemed just very natural and easy here.
Well, with scenes like that, I mean, we just... It was down to do, and then we just sort of
we
hardly rehearsed it.
We did
it on the spot.
Yeah,
we?
That was so. I mean, there are so many scenes I love, and but
those
I did,
kind of scenes.
Yeah, that's that, and I do remember working and forever now Waterloo and that. I mean, there are several places around town now with
which have got
ghosts.
Yes,
but Waterloo and that corner of it and that street and that bookshop will always be Poppy and her bike and meeting that the man in the bookshop and the monosyllabic man in the hat and that will be Poppy and I will see Poppy there
It is great. That's one of the great things about making movies on location and on location in your home city, which we.
I mean, London for you is.
I did a thing. If I really stopped, every time I went past a place that had a film meaning for me, or you know, I just never met, never complete a journey in less than a half a day. Really.
Must be every.
There's a great documentary called LA Completes Its, LA Plays Itself. It doesn't get shown a lot because they can't clear the clips, but it's all the things that have been shot in Los Angeles and place to place, and kind of explaining how you know, they're driving down one street and then they up in another side of town, and what monuments they use and everything else. But you could have Mike Leigh's journey.
I did it for London Time Out actually, and I went around. We spent 2 days going to different locations and me talking about them, and you
it's
saw
a nice idea.
Yeah. But you know, people say, "Oh well," people call me the London film. And the reason why I make films in London, we always make our films in London. Every time we make a film, we say, "Well, let's see if we can go out of town or go elsewhere, or even to Europe or something." but we can never afford it because they're such low budget movies. You know, we can only afford to be in London. We did manage to go to Southend-on-Sea to visit the sister. Which was a major operation.
It was good, though.
You see other filmmakers struggling to get funding and to make their movies and do things, particularly in England in the last number of years.
Yeah.
Does that affect you? Or are you involved with that? And
I am, and I'm very involved with young filmmakers. I'm the chairman of the governors of the London Film School. Actually, we're going to have a screening of Happy Go Lucky in to draw attention to and raise some money for the London Film School in LA in a few weeks' time, which we're going to be at. And I'm very concerned with young filmmakers. And I think it's there are two sides of this. I think it's the bad news is that there isn't a lot of funding for regular films, and that young filmmakers suffer terribly from people who give them money and then won't leave them alone to get on with it, who interfere and behave in a way that was invented by Louis B. Mayer and is inappropriate in that context in the UK or anywhere else for that matter. They just don't give them the freedom to explore. They do behave like Hollywood moguls. But the good news is that new technology is fantastic, and people, kids, whoever, can get their hands on the stuff and get out there and make what are actually films, you know, in all kinds of ways. And it's very exciting. And the cinema of the future, and that's the near future, will, I mean, it's changing all the time. It will change in how people watch movies and what movies are and who makes them and who decides what they are. I mean, we're still very much, you know, in the grip of exhibitors and distributors, not to mention backers. And that will change, you know, and it's being democratized just as the internet is democratizing the world. So I think it's both bad news and good. And actually, anything I would say about the UK applies anywhere, really, I would say.
Well, for you, would it be, is making the, or making your pictures, is the box office and things like that about getting the money to make the next picture?
Yeah.
Or is it a sense of pride in and of itself, or do you even worry about that?
Well, no. I worry about all these things. I worry about the box office and the next picture because the people who back the films worry about those things. I mean, I can worry about whatever I like, but I don't have any money. We are given the money by backers, and backers at the end may, I mean, be impressed by the Palme d'Or or the Golden Lion at Venice, or Sally Hawkins winning the Silver Bear at Berlin, or the fact that we have had Oscar nominations and we may well have them again. Who knows? I mean, in the end, it's about box office. It's about returns. It's about bread. And these things, you know.
I always find it, it's just amazing and baffling and weird that you...
Have difficulty. We struggle.
Each time.
I know.
It's Mike Leigh. It's like, God.
Well, if only you were a millionaireess.
I know.
You could back all the movies.
Give you a fiver.
Okay.
Well, maybe you'll give him another gold statue.
Yeah.
That's what everybody's talking about, and it seems like you're very reluctant.
Well, it just it's lovely that that's even people talking about it. It seems so insane, but
it's not insane, and I'll tell you why it's not insane. Okay. Because actually, I would be hard put to think that any actress has done a better performance than you have in any film that's been made in the last couple of years. That's up for it. So I think it has to be entirely feasible. What do you think?
I'm moving. We're at least 2 out of 3 in this room.
Well, that's, yeah, okay.
Well, thank you guys for coming. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
And lovely job.
Thank you. Nice talking to you.
Yeah, lovely to meet you.
Yeah.